Good morning. We have come together today to share our sorrow and to bid farewell to David Bloom. We recall today the blessing of his life, and we thank God for all that was good and true in his life, and for the precious memories that shall always endure. Eternal God, Creator and merciful Father of all, your children bowed in grief seek light to dispel the dark gloom. Be gracious to those who mourn, for they are in distress. Bless them with your compassion, O God. Ease their burden of sorrow. Send them light and peace. In this time, we now listen to the voice of our sacred scriptures that brings us the ever new message of God's nearness. It tells us of our kinship with our Creator, and light is in darkness, and joy is in sorrow, and life is in death. Psalm 23. Mizmor le David, Adonai roi lo echsar, binodesha yerbatseni, ome menuchot yinchaleni, nashi yeshovev, enchene me'agle tzedek leman shemo, lo ira ra ki ata imadi, shivtecha umishantecha, hema yinachumuni, torach lefanai shochan neged sorarai, dishanta vashemen roshi kosi rinaya, ach tov echesed yirafuni koyime hayai, v'shavti bebeit Adonai le'orech yamim. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not fear. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in straight paths for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You've anointed my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Once, the poet Ralph Waldo Emerson wrote the following definition of success. It is the best one I have found, and I think truly defines our loved one David. Quote, he who has achieved success, who has lived well, laughed often, and loved much, who has enjoyed the trust of a pure woman, the respect of intelligent men, and the love of little children, who has filled his niche and accomplished his task, who has left the world better than he found it, who has never lacked appreciation of the earth's beauty or failed to express it, whose life was an inspiration, whose memory was a benediction. And this fits right in with the Jewish tradition's definition of success. As King David taught us in the book of Psalms, that the measure of success is one's ability to do the right thing day by day, every day. In this spirit, when we look back over the life of David Bloom, we see a life of goodness, hard work, a devotion to family, and an undying love for his soulmate, Dolores. David was born on August 19, 1935, in the Hyde Park neighborhood of Chicago, Illinois, the eldest son of Alex and Martha Bloom. He was blessed with two brothers, Jerry and Lenny. He graduated Hyde Park High School, where he played guard and linebacker for his high school football team. He went off to the University of Illinois, where he majored in accounting and was a member of the Tau Epsilon Pi fraternity. Years later, David first met the love of his life at a Thanksgiving dinner, where David's cousin Margie invited her good friend, Dolores Fishman. Several years later, after seeing Dolores at the beach, David was smitten and mustered the courage to finally ask her out. Dolores said yes, but after a few dates, the yeses turned into noes. However, David did not despair. And after repeated requests, Dolores finally agreed to a date at a bowling banquet, according to him, his first and biggest sales job ever. This would be the turning point in their relationship, as his charm bowled her over, and they were married not long after at the Blackstone Hotel in Chicago. Soon after the marriage, they took an apartment on the south side of Chicago, where they began expanding their family. They were blessed with five children, Stephen, Kenny, Jeffrey, Diane, and Lisa. And after the birth of three boys, they soon moved into a home in Glencoe, Illinois. And desiring a girl, they were eventually blessed with twins. David always made activities fun for his family. He had a charisma and a beautiful smile that allowed him to often enjoy life, especially with those he loved. He was there as a father, and despite a difficult work and travel schedule, he would do the best he could to be there for his five children. David enjoyed spending time with his children and participated often in Cub Scouts and Indian Princesses. He had very high expectations of those he loved. He had a very competitive spirit, and he wanted everyone around him to be the best they could. He often pushed others to do more, whether they liked it or not. There was an expectation that, like him, you too would always do the right thing, would always be kind, and would always work hard. If you were going to do anything, you were going to do it with all the passion you had, or you weren't going to do it at all. That is how David lived his life. For 55 years, he was blessed to be married to Dolores. He never said no to her. He adored her more than anyone. They spent most of their free time together. They loved each other's company and had a great respect for each other. She valued the fact that he worked hard and took care of her and the family. Yes, David was a physically big and very strong man, and at times he could get angry, but he would always come back and apologize and attempt to make it right. His expectations were always tempered by his kind and gentle neshama, his kind and gentle soul. Everyone respected him for it. He was a large, but yet a very gentle giant. And David adored Dolores. And despite both being very friendly people, they spent most of their free time in just enjoying each other's company, dining out, and traveling. Over the years, he and Dolores took the family on many trips to London, Paris, Israel, Disney World, Aruba, Italy, and the Ozarks. He especially enjoyed the many Memorial Day weekend fishing trips to Eagle River, Wisconsin, where despite a real lack of angler talent, he holds the family record for the biggest fish, a 30-inch, 7-pound walleye, proof of which is still hanging in a grandson's room. And most irksome, I've been told to his children, is that it was the first and only fish he ever caught. He was always up. Nothing could hurt his morale. He was a real optimist with a special zest for life. He loved eating and trying everything. Eating out with him was extra special. If he couldn't decide what he wanted, he always ordered both sides, both dishes, one for the middle of the table for everyone to try. And not only could he appreciate fine dining, but he got more pleasure from eating at a greasy spoon or stopping at a local taqueria. A lifelong ambition for him was running a marathon, and in his mid-50s, he achieved his goal by completing the New York Marathon. In addition to his wife and his children and grandchildren, hard work would be the focus of his life. Initially, David supported the family by selling insurance, which he really didn't like, and filled the day mostly with going to the movies. However, as luck would have it, his father-in-law had just invented a new kind of tire and needed someone to drive sales. Bearcat Tire Company was born, and David leveraged his charisma and passion to excel, soon helping to build Bearcat into a leader in the industrial tire industry. Later, he would leave Bearcat to start his own industrial tire companies, Tire Town and Chicago Industrial Tire, selling and servicing customers around the world. In 1993, after a fire had forced the sale of Tire Town, David and Dolores moved here to Houston and started a new life in Kingwood. And David soon got busy building another business, and Phoenix Industrial Tire emerged from the embers of Tire Town. David would lead and grow this business up until his final 6 months of life. He'll be fondly remembered for his favorite slogan, "I don't care what you need to do, just get it done," as well as the words, "Caring is everything," emblazoned on the side of his truck. More importantly, he will be remembered for the countless employees he inspired to build their own businesses and be better people. David Bloom was a good man and a caring husband, father, brother, friend, grandfather, and mentor. He never said anything negative or unkind about anyone, even when deserved. First and foremost, David was a mensch. He survived by his wife of 55 years, Dolores, and five children, Lisa, Diane, Jeffrey, Stephen, and Kenneth. Three daughter-in-laws, Mona, Amy, and Amy. He's also survived by 10 grandchildren. He was a wonderful Zadie to Sydney, Matthew, Evan, Samuel, Jared, Brandon, Benjamin, Jonathan, Maxwell, and Michael. David's influence will continue to be with so many of us for many years to come. His memory will remain as a valued example for future generations. How fortunate are all those who've been blessed by David Bloom. Today, David, we say farewell with pride that we knew you, with admiration for your strength and spirit and courage, with gratitude for all that you did give us. We say farewell with the prayer that God will grant you everlasting peace and that reward which the good and the loving receive in God's presence. Zichrono Livracha. May the good life of David Bloom be for a blessing to us always, and may his soul be bound up in the bond of eternal life, together with the souls of all the righteous that are in God's keeping. And to this let us say, Amen. It's my pleasure to have a few of his family members say some loving words about their father. First, his son Stephen.
Good morning. Thank you for coming here to honor the memory of my father. When I was 16 or 17, my father invited me to join him on a business trip through the South Central USA. The plan was to visit Chattanooga, Tennessee, Tulsa, Oklahoma, and lastly, Houston, Texas. And it would require that I miss about 3 or 4 days of school. I had not yet worked for my father and seen him in action, in his element, nor did I understand how this trip would impact my view of David Bloom as a father and a human being. I was glad just to miss school and spend a few days with him. I'm not sure which was more important at the time. I was soon to discover, however, that Dad was not just a good salesman. He was a different person than the man I knew at home. Before departing for the airport, we made a side trip to Fannie Mae Candies to get some gift boxes for the customers that we would be visiting. We pulled up to the strip mall, Dad entered the store, and strode to the counter. "I'd like a 10-pound box of candy," he called to the salesperson behind the counter. "Would 10 1-pound boxes be okay?" she replied. "They're over there at the display," pointing to the back of the store. "No, I'd like one 10-pound box of candy," he answered with simple certainty. "I'm sorry, sir. I don't have any 10-pound boxes at the counter. I have to get them out of the back." "That's okay. We'll wait." I turned to Dad. "Dad, what's so important about a 10-pound box of candy? They have boxes over there, and we have a flight to catch." "Stephen," he said with a big smile on his face, "if I show up with a 1-pound box of candy, it's just like everybody else. If I show up with a 10-pound box, it's a conversation piece." Resuming our journey, we headed to the airport, 10-pound boxes of candy in tow. Our first stop was Chattanooga, Tennessee. I can't recall much about the actual business meetings that day or who we met, but remember vividly our lunch at the Chattanooga Choo Choo. We were joined by one other customer, making us a party of three. It was still early, and the restaurant was only half full. Seating us immediately, the hostess distributed menus and took our beverage order. A quick glance at the menu informed the diner that the menu was limited, and that there were only 4 entrees, instantly creating and resolving a dilemma for Dad. I had dined with him before, but our customer had not. He, our customer, ordered the ham. I ordered something long forgotten, and Dad ordered the remaining 2 entrees. While I was not surprised, and those of you who have dined with Dad are probably not either, our customer looked at Dad with a peculiar expression on his face. "I didn't know you were that hungry." "I'm not," said Dad, "but I always order something for Elijah so we can try it." The next morning, we boarded a plane for Tulsa. Exiting the plane, the tarmac greeted us with swirling gusts of red rose dust. With the support of Hearst's, we were soon dashing to our next customer, one of Tulsa's premier forklift dealers. Dad announced us to the receptionist, where the sales manager enthusiastically welcomed and escorted us into their conference room. After 5 or 6 quick introductions of Dad to various members of the dealership staff, we took our seats and the performance began. Dad was dazzling. And a ham. I had seen him make presentations at school and lead Cub Scout pack meetings, but I had never seen him perform in front of an audience. "My name is Dave Bloom," he started, looking at the others with eyes bright and voice animated. "I got into this business by marrying the boss's daughter of Bearcat Tire Company." Amid chuckles, my focus faded as I watched the transformation of Dad from my father to professional. He commanded the attention of every person in the room, fielding questions and explaining sales strategies, showcasing the facet of him I had never seen before, and providing a glimpse into what I have come to understand was the real source of his strength, the confidence and passion of a salesman who truly believes in the value of what he is selling. My respect and admiration for his capabilities grew. I had heard his introduction often. Marrying Dolores Fishman was his greatest achievement, second only to the pride he took in his sons and daughters. Dad wrapped up the meeting, obtaining order commitments for his new line of imported European tires, but declined lunch. Houston was our final destination, and our schedule was tight. With minutes to spare, we were soon relaxing on our next flight. We arrived in Houston on a cloudless but humid night in late spring. I was tired and a bit bored from the endless jetting, but looking forward to my last evening with Dad. In the morning, he had scheduled an appointment at Golf Co., a foundry located in Beaumont, and the last scene of our trip together. Dressed in business suits and Oxfords, the dawn found us driving on I-10 amidst darkened skies, dodging occasional downpours. Reaching our destination, we were soon seated in the cramped office of the general manager, where Dad began explaining the features of his new tires and the benefits they would bring to Golf Co. The plant manager wouldn't hear it. "We have a very demanding environment here at Golf Co., and standard tires won't hold up. We only use laminated tires, custom made for our application." I expected Dad to give up, as the manager was clearly uninterested. Instead, he tacked. "Can we have a plant tour?" he requested. "Sure, come on," the manager replied, jumping from his seat. The skies had cleared, but still carried an ominous potential. Black thunderheads loomed in the distance, threatening to release their angry torrent. Following the manager, Dad and I toured the presses, forges, furnaces, and yard. To my untrained eye, the place was a dump, literally. Among puddles and patches of grass and gravel, the yard was strewn with old tires, rusting machinery, and irregular forgings. Some of the junk heaps were 5 to 6 feet high. Dad wandered off, leaving me to chat with the plant manager. Dressed in his suit and shoes, he began hopping and climbing over all the old tires, examining them with the eye of a forensic scientist looking for a cause of failure. The image was comical. He looked like a 6-foot, spindly-legged, barrel-chested sprite flitting from one tire to the next. An elven Humpty Dumpty. Upon completing his examination, he shouted to the plant manager, "Would you please come over here and take a look at this?" Without going into technical detail, Dad took the next 30 minutes to patiently explain and show to the plant manager that the laminated tires he had so proudly exclaimed had solved one problem and created another, more costly problem. Walking back to the office, the humbled plant manager thanked Dad for such a refreshing and eye-opening experience and promised to get back with him. He never did. As we drove back to the airport for a return to Chicago, we discussed this last appointment and what had happened. "Steven," he said, "I told you, the best salesmen aren't problem solvers, they're problem creators." It's almost 40 years since we spent those days together as father and son, days that are just as clear to me today as they were that spring. I've lost a good friend, father, and teacher. I will miss his smile, but take comfort knowing that I will always carry a piece of him with me inside.
Hello, thank you for coming. For those that don't know me, I'm Jeff Bloom. I'm the third son I wanted to say a few words. I didn't prepare as much as Stephen did. And Rabbi, thank you for those words. You stole a lot of my material while I'm up here. But I guess first, just a little humor. When we were all planning where the funeral would be, we talked about whether we should do it in Houston or in Chicago. And obviously we're here in Houston. And as my cousin Ross pointed out to me yesterday, he said the heat index is going to be 108. I checked this morning on the way while I was actually preparing what I was going to talk about. I think the heat index was 76, low humidity, much more comfortable. So David apologizes. We all apologize for the heat. What I'm here to talk about really is a son's love for his father. I didn't prepare a lot. It's a kind of a collection of random thoughts. I loved my father very, very much, and I think all of us here did as well. He was a special man who had a big impact on many of us. I kind of broke this into, you know, David as the teacher to me personally, David as a role model, and then David as kind of just being playful. As a teacher, I think the theme of get it done, Jeffrey, was something that I heard constantly. In fact, when I went to visit him, three weeks ago, and he was on his deathbed, literally. Here I am trying to do a special project for myself. It's not yet done. I have a difficult client. And in his kind of very shallow voice, he said those words to me, Jeffrey, just get it done. And now that we're talking about it here, it's very special. And it's something that I will carry with me for a long, long time. Finishing. Some of you may not know the story of my personal story about my boat. I was not allowed to go to college. In fact, I probably still have to give back my degree because I wasn't supposed to go to college.
It's still unfinished.
And it's still unfinished. And I'll admit that today. It is still unfinished. But I was not supposed to go to college until my boat was finished. And I will tell you, my poor wife, my sons are tortured by that recurring, just finish it. All of my wife's projects, they're not finished. I always say, we finish them. So thank you. Thank you, David. What else? A couple of things. I was talking to Benny about what Zadie has taught him. And on a light-sided note, he mentioned the cardboard keyboard. He always talked about the expertise he had being able to play the cardboard keyboard. And then the last one, I guess, is about eating. His zest for enjoying food, always ordering two of everything. It was wonderful. We loved and enjoyed all that time with him. So moving on to a role model, hard work. I think it instilled upon many of us his ability to work very, very hard. Even when he had colon cancer back in 8 years ago or 7 years ago, whatever it was, he still was getting into that truck. And he'd go and get his chemo, he'd get back in that truck, and he would go drive, do some calls, help, you know, in the back. It was incredible. I personally, I don't think I could ever go through that type of suffering in terms of recovering and still be able to work. An inspiration to all of us. Perseverance, strength, grit, all similar to the same thing. Much of the things that he shared with me. But on a gentler note, his kindness. David was a very kind and very loving father, man, friend to me and to many of us. And I think that is as a role model to me personally, something that's very, very special. Last piece is around playfulness. I was, and I still am a little competitive with my brothers and my family and my father. Many of you don't know, I competed against my father in throwing a football regularly. And up until he was, I was going to bring a football just 3 weeks ago to challenge him to a thing. He had his hip replaced, and I was still competing against him to see who could throw the ball further. At that time, I was throwing it further than him, but it took until the hip replacement to ultimately be the one to do it. I'm gonna end there. I guess there are some things about my legendary fights with him as a son. They were never ending, and I will forever miss them. They were beautiful moments, That's the spoons. That's what I was talking about. Yes, it was beautiful. But I'm just gonna end on this. And I think that this, to me, this fits into the role model for all of us. We were all in Kemahatchee, I think, most of us were there, in Northbrook, Illinois. I don't think, Steve, if you were there at the time. And there were, sitting there was, four or five or six or eight or whatever the number of children and his son-in-laws and daughter-in-laws and... eight, nine, ten. There may have been some friends that were thrown in there of his grandkids thrown in there. So, in front of him, he was sitting there, and there were 18 children and children of his that he has had a life with, and he has had such an influence with. And I was just talking to him, and we all knew his health was failing. And I just asked him. I said, "How does this? Behold, all of this is before you. How do you feel about this?" And the peace that he had when he said, nothing makes me happier, is something that we all should cherish, and we should all hope for ourselves that we could have. So, thank you.
Thank you, Stephen, and thank you, Jeffrey. And may you continue to share those positive memories, those blessings, that precious legacy with the grandchildren, and one day the great-grandchildren. So the Zikron al Livracha, so his memory is always a blessing, and that he always continues to rest in peace. You have a lot to be proud about, and may continue to share those proud memories for many, many years to come. Now I ask you to please rise for the El Malei Rachamim. El Malei Rachamim. Shokain Bam Romim, Hamenitza Menucha Nechona Tachat Kanfe Hashkina, Bemaalot Kiddushim Utoharim, Kizor Harakia Mazirim, Et Nishmat David Ben Nachum Shmuel, Shalachal Olamo, Begad Aden Tehem Menuchato, Ana Bal Harachamim, Hasterecha Reseter Kenafecha Laolamim. Utzor bitzor, hahayim et nishmato, arnaihu nachalato, v'anuach b'shalom, al mishkovo, v'nomar, amen. El Malei Rachamim, exalted, compassionate God, grant infinite rest in your sheltering presence among the holy and pure to the soul of David ben Nachum Shmuel, who has gone to his eternal home. Merciful, we ask that our loved one find perfect peace in your eternal embrace. May his soul be bound up in the bond of life, and may he rest in peace always. And let us say, Amen. V'yashov ha'afar ha'aretz k'shahaya v'aruach tashuv el ha'elohim asher netana. The dust returns to the earth as it was, but the spirit returns to God who gave it. Adonai, Adonai el rachum v'chanun. The Lord our God is a compassionate God. He understands our pain and he shares our anguish. The dust returns to the earth from which it came, but the spirit goes back to God who gave it. What we put away are only the earthly material remains of the one we loved and cherished. What has been most precious to us never dies, but continues to bless and inspire us on the paths of life we tread. Their good name is a crown that will never fade. Their good life is a priceless memory to all their dear ones and to all of us. Receive in mercy and loving kindness, O Lord, the soul of our dear departed. Grant him that everlasting peace and bliss which are our portion in the world to come. May we all be given the strength, the courage, and the faith to be worthy of life and of the memory of those we loved. We now remain standing for the words of the mourner's Kaddish. Yitzgadal v'yikadash shemei rabah. V'yamad ivrach yurte v'yamlich machute v'chayehon v'yomechon v'chayeh d'chol beit Yisrael v'agala v'zman kari v'yemru Amen Yehe shmei rabba mevorach le'olam ome amaya Yitbarak v'yishtabak v'yitbar v'yitroman v'yitnase v'yitadar v'yitale v'yitalal shmei d'kudushah b'richu le'ela min kol berkata v'shirata Tushbechata v'nechemata, Dami Ram Biyama Viamru Amen. Yehe Shlama Rabba Min Shemaya. V'chayim Aleinu V'yakol Yisrael V'yemru Amen. Osei Shalom Bimromav Hu Ya'asei Shalom Aleinu V'yakol Yisrael V'yemru Amen. Everyone is invited to Amy and Stephen's home at 3019 Greenwood Glen Drive, and that is in Kingwood, immediately following our service. And your company will be greatly appreciated by the family. That's 3019 Greenwood Glen Drive in Kingwood. In just a moment, we'll have an opportunity to participate in the burial. I'll have the family go first and put some dirt in here, right on top of the coffin. And after all the family goes, then we'll close it, and then we'll have an opportunity for everyone, including family, to participate in the burial. It's a great mitzvah. It's considered a mitzvah chesed shel emet, a mitzvah we give back to David for all that he gave to us in his life. Hamakom yerechem etchem. May God offer comfort to all those who mourn for Zion and Jerusalem and for this family this morning and for the days, weeks to come. And let us now begin the burial. together, and despite a difficult work and travel schedule, he would do the best he could to be there for his five children. David enjoyed spending time with his children and participated often in Cub Scouts and Indian Princesses. He had very high expectations of those he loved. He had a very competitive spirit, and he wanted everyone around him to be the best they could. He often pushed others to do more, whether they liked it or not. There was an expectation that, like him, you too would always do the right thing, would always be kind, and would always work hard. If you were going to do anything, you were going to do it with all the passion you had, or you weren't going to do it at all. That is how David lived his life. For 55 years, he was blessed to be married to Dolores. He never said no to her. He adored her more than anyone. They spent most of their free time together. They loved each other's company and had a great respect for each other. She valued the fact that he worked hard and took care of her and the family. Yes, David was a physically big and very strong man, and at times he could get angry, but he would always come back and apologize and attempt to make it right. His expectations were always tempered by his kind and gentle neshama, his kind and gentle soul. Everyone respected him for it. He was a large, but yet a very gentle giant. And David adored Dolores. And despite both being very friendly people, they spent most of their free time in just enjoying each other's company, dining out, and traveling. Over the years, he and Dolores took the family on many trips to London, Paris, Israel, Disney World, Aruba, Italy, and the Ozarks. He especially enjoyed the many Memorial Day weekend fishing trips to Eagle River, Wisconsin, where despite a real lack of angler talent, he holds the family record for the biggest fish, a 30-inch, 7-pound walleye, proof of which is still hanging in a grandson's room. And most irksome, I've been told, to his children is that it was the first and only fish he ever caught. He was always up. Nothing could hurt his morale. He was a real optimist with a special zest for life. He loved eating and trying everything. Eating out with him was extra special. If he couldn't decide what he wanted, he always ordered both sides, both dishes, one for the middle of the table for everyone to try. And not only could he appreciate fine dining, but he got more pleasure from eating at a greasy spoon or stopping at a local taqueria. A lifelong ambition for him was running a marathon, and in his mid-50s, he achieved his goal by completing the New York Marathon. In addition to his wife and his children and grandchildren, hard work would be the focus of his life. Initially, David supported the family by selling insurance, which he really didn't like, and filled the day mostly with going to the movies. However, as luck would have it, his father-in-law had just invented a new kind of tire and needed someone to drive sales. Bearcat Tire Company was born, and David leveraged his charisma and passion to excel, soon helping to build Bearcat into a leader in the industrial tire industry. Later, he would leave Bearcat to start his own industrial tire companies, Tire Town and Chicago Industrial Tire, selling and servicing customers around the world. In 1993, after a fire had forced the sale of Tire Town, David and Dolores moved here to Houston and started a new life in Kingwood. And David soon got busy building another business, and Phoenix Industrial Tire emerged from the embers of Tire Town. David would lead and grow this business up until his final 6 months of life. He'll be fondly remembered for his favorite slogan, "I don't care what you need to do, just get it done," as well as the words, "Caring is everything," emblazoned on the side of his truck. More importantly, he will be remembered for the countless employees he inspired to build their own businesses and be better people. David Bloom was a good man and a caring husband, father, brother, friend, grandfather, and mentor. He never said anything negative or unkind about anyone, even when deserved. First and foremost, David was a mensch. He survived by his wife of 55 years, Dolores, and five children, Lisa, Diane, Jeffrey, Stephen, and Kenneth. Three daughter-in-laws, Mona, Amy, and Amy. He's also survived by 10 grandchildren. He was a wonderful Zadie to Sydney, Matthew, Evan, Samuel, Jared, Brandon, Benjamin, Jonathan, Maxwell, and Michael. David's influence will continue to be with so many of us for many years to come. His memory will remain as a valued example for future generations. How fortunate are all those who've been blessed by David Bloom. Today, David, we say farewell with pride that we knew you, with admiration for your strength and spirit and courage, with gratitude for all that you did give us. We say farewell with the prayer that God will grant you everlasting peace and that reward which the good and the loving receive in God's presence. Zikorno Livracha. May the good life of David Bloom be for a blessing to us always, and may his soul be bound up in the bond of eternal life, together with the souls of all the righteous that are in God's keeping. And to this let us say, Amen. It's my pleasure to have a few of his family members say some loving words about their father. First, his son Stephen.
Good morning. Thank you for coming here to honor the memory of my father. When I was 16 or 17, my father invited me to join him on a business trip through the South Central USA. The plan was to visit Chattanooga, Tennessee, Tulsa, Oklahoma, and lastly, Houston, Texas. It would require that I miss about 3 or 4 days of school. I had not yet worked for my father and seen him in action, in his element, nor did I understand how this trip would impact my view of David Bloom as a father and a human being. I was glad just to miss school and spend a few days with him. I'm not sure which was more important at the time. I was soon to discover, however, that Dad was not just a good salesman. He was a different person than the man I knew at home. Before departing for the airport, we made a side trip to Fannie Mae Candies to get some gift boxes for the customers that we would be visiting. We pulled up to the strip mall, Dad entered the store, and strode to the counter. "I'd like a 10-pound box of candy," he called to the salesperson behind the counter. "Would 10 1-pound boxes be okay?" she replied. "They're over there at the display," pointing to the back of the store. "No, I'd like one 10-pound box of candy," he answered with simple certainty. "I'm sorry, sir. I don't have any 10-pound boxes at the counter. I have to get them out of the back." "That's okay. We'll wait." I turned to Dad. "Dad, what's so important about a 10-pound box of candy? They have boxes over there, and we have a flight to catch." "Stephen," he said with a big smile on his face, "if I show up with a 1-pound box of candy, it's just like everybody else. If I show up with a 10-pound box, it's a conversation piece." Resuming our journey, we headed to the airport, 10-pound boxes of candy in tow. Our first stop was Chattanooga, Tennessee. I can't recall much about the actual business meetings that day or who we met, but remember vividly our lunch at the Chattanooga Choo Choo. We were joined by one other customer, making us a party of three. It was still early, and the restaurant was only half full. Seating us immediately, the hostess distributed menus and took our beverage order. A quick glance at the menu informed the diner that the menu was limited and that there were only 4 entrees, instantly creating and resolving a dilemma for Dad. I had dined with him before, but our customer had not. He, our customer, ordered the ham. I ordered something long forgotten, and Dad ordered the remaining 2 entrees. While I was not surprised, and those of you who have dined with Dad are probably not either, our customer looked at Dad with a peculiar expression on his face. "I didn't know you were that hungry." "I'm not," said Dad, "but I always order something for Elijah so we can try it." The next morning, we boarded a plane for Tulsa. Exiting the plane, the tarmac greeted us with swirling gusts of red rose dust. With the support of Hearst's, we were soon dashing to our next customer, one of Tulsa's premier forklift dealers. Dad announced us to the receptionist, where the sales manager enthusiastically welcomed and escorted us into their conference room. After 5 or 6 quick introductions of Dad to various members of the dealership staff, we took our seats and the performance began. Dad was dazzling. And a ham. I had seen him make presentations at school and lead Cub Scout pack meetings, but I had never seen him perform in front of an audience. "My name is Dave Bloom," he started, looking at the others with eyes bright and voice animated. "I got into this business by marrying the boss's daughter of Bearcat Tire Company." Amid chuckles, my focus faded as I watched the transformation of Dad from my father to professional. He commanded the attention of every person in the room, fielding questions and explaining sales strategies, showcasing a facet of him I had never seen before, and providing a glimpse into what I have come to understand was the real source of his strength, the confidence and passion of a salesman who truly believes in the value of what he is selling. My respect and admiration for his capabilities grew. I had heard his introduction often. Marrying Dolores Fishman was his greatest achievement, second only to the pride he took in his sons and daughters. Dad wrapped up the meeting, obtaining order commitments for his new line of imported European tires, but declined lunch. Houston was our final destination, and our schedule was tight. With minutes to spare, we were soon relaxing on our next flight. We arrived in Houston on a cloudless but humid night in late spring. I was tired and a bit bored from the endless jetting, but looking forward to my last evening with Dad. In the morning, he had scheduled an appointment at Gulf Co., a foundry located in Beaumont, and the last scene of our trip together. Dressed in business suits and Oxfords, the dawn found us driving on I-10 amidst darkened skies, dodging occasional downpours. Reaching our destination, we were soon seated in the cramped office of the general manager, where Dad began explaining the features of his new tires and the benefits they would bring to Gulf Co. The plant manager wouldn't hear it. "We have a very demanding environment here at Gulf Co., and standard tires won't hold up. We only use laminated tires, custom made for our application." I expected Dad to give up, as the manager was clearly uninterested. Instead, he tacked. "Can we have a plant tour?" he requested. "Sure, come on," the manager replied, jumping from his seat. The skies had cleared, but still carried an ominous potential. Black thunderheads loomed in the distance, threatening to release their angry torrent. Following the manager, Dad and I toured the presses, forges, furnaces, and yard. To my untrained eye, the place was a dump, literally. Among puddles and patches of grass and gravel, the yard was strewn with old tires, rusting machinery, and irregular forgings. Some of the junk heaps were 5 to 6 feet high. Dad wandered off, leaving me to chat with the plant manager. Dressed in his suit and shoes, he began hopping and climbing over all the old tires, examining them with the eye of a forensic scientist looking for a cause of failure. The image was comical. He looked like a 6-foot, spindly-legged, barrel-chested sprite flitting from one tire to the next. An elven Humpty Dumpty. Upon completing his examination, he shouted to the plant manager, "Would you please come over here and take a look at this?" Without going into technical detail, Dad took the next 30 minutes to patiently explain and show to the plant manager that the laminated tires he had so proudly exclaimed had solved one problem and created another, more costly problem. Walking back to the office, the humbled plant manager thanked Dad for such a refreshing and eye-opening experience and promised to get back with him. He never did. As we drove back to the airport for a return to Chicago, we discussed this last appointment and what had happened. "Steven," he said, "I told you, the best salesmen aren't problem solvers, they're problem creators." It's almost 40 years since we spent those days together as father and son, days that are just as clear to me today as they were that spring. I've lost a good friend, father, and teacher. I will miss his smile, but take comfort knowing that I will always carry a piece of him with me inside.
Hello, thank you for coming. For those that don't know me, I'm Jeff Bloom. I'm the third son. I wanted to say a few words. I didn't prepare as much as Stephen did. And Rabbi, thank you for those words. You stole a lot of my material. while I'm up here. But I guess first, just a little humor. When we were all planning where the funeral would be, we talked about whether we should do it in Houston or in Chicago. And obviously we're here in Houston. And as my cousin Ross pointed out to me yesterday, he said the heat index was going to be 108. I checked this morning on the way while I was actually preparing what I was going to talk about. I think the heat index was 76, low humidity, much more comfortable. So David apologizes. We all apologize for the heat. What I'm here to talk about really is a son's love for his father. I didn't prepare a lot. It's a kind of a collection of random thoughts. I loved my father very, very much, and I think all of us here did as well. He was a special man who had a big impact on many of us. I kind of broke this into, David as the teacher to me personally, David as a role model, and then David as kind of just being playful. As a teacher, I think the theme of get it done, Jeffrey, was something that I heard constantly. In fact, when I went to visit him, three weeks ago, and he was on his deathbed, literally. Here I am trying to do a special project for myself. It's not yet done. I have a difficult client. And in his kind of very shallow voice, he said those words to me, Jeffrey, just get it done. And it was. And now that we're talking about it here, it's very special. And it's something that I will carry with me for a long, long time. Finishing. Some of you may not know the story of my personal story about my boat. I was not allowed to go to college. In fact, I probably still have to give back my degree because I wasn't supposed to go to college.
It's still unfinished.
And it's still unfinished. And I'll admit that today. It is still unfinished. But I was not supposed to go to college until my boat was finished. And I will tell you, my poor wife, my sons are tortured by that recurring, just finish it. All of my wife's projects, they're not finished. I always say, we finish them. So thank you. Thank you, David. What else? A couple of things I was talking to Benny about what Zadie has taught him. And on a light-sided note, he mentioned the cardboard keyboard. He always talked about the expertise he had being able to play the cardboard keyboard. And then the last one, I guess, is about eating. His zest for enjoying food, always ordering two of everything. It was wonderful. We loved and enjoyed all that time with him. So moving on to a role model, hard work. I think it instilled upon many of us his ability to work very, very hard. Even when he had colon cancer back in 8 years ago or 7 years ago, whatever it was, he still was getting into that truck. And he'd go and get his chemo, he'd get back in that truck, and he would go drive, do some calls, help, in the back. It was incredible. I personally, I don't think I could ever go through that type of suffering in terms of recovering and still be able to work. An inspiration to all of us. Perseverance, strength, grit, all similar to the same thing. Much of the things that he shared with me. But on a gentler note, his kindness. David was a very kind and very loving father, man, friend to me and to many of us. And I think that is as a role model to me personally, something that's very, very special. Last piece is around playfulness. I still am a little competitive with my brothers and my family and my father. Many of you don't know, I competed against my father in throwing a football regularly. And I was going to bring a football just 3 weeks ago to challenge him to a thing. He had his hip replaced, and I was still competing against him to see who could throw the ball further. At that time, I was throwing it further than him, but it took until the hip replacement to ultimately be the one to do it. I'm gonna end there. I guess I had some things about my legendary fights with him as a son. They were never ending, and I will forever miss them. They were beautiful moments. That's the spoons. That's what I was talking about. Yes, it was beautiful. But I'm just gonna end on this. And I think that this, to me, this fits into the role model for all of us. We were all in Kemahatchee, I think, most of us were there, in Northbrook, Illinois. I don't think, Steve, if you were there at the time. And there were, sitting there was, four or five or six or eight or whatever the number of children and his son-in-laws and daughter-in-laws and, eight, nine, ten, there may have been some friends that were thrown in there of his grandkids thrown in there. So in front of him, he was sitting there, and there were 18 children, and children of his, that he has had a life with, and he has had such an influence with. And I was just talking to him, and we all knew his health was failing. And I just asked him, I said, how does this, behold, all of this is before you. How do you feel about this? And the peace that he had when he said, nothing makes me happier, is something that we all should cherish, and we should all hope for ourselves that we could have. So, thank you.
Thank you, Stephen, and thank you, Jeffrey. And may you continue to share those positive memories, those blessings, that precious legacy with the grandchildren and one day the great-grandchildren. So Zichrono Livracha, so his memory is always a blessing, and that he always continues to rest in peace. You have a lot to be proud about, and may continue to share those proud memories for many, many years to come. Now I ask you to please rise for the El Malei Rachamim. El Malei Rachamim, Shokein Bamromim, Hamenitza Menucha, Nechona Tachat Kanvei Hashkina, Bema'alot Kiddushim, Utohorim, Kizohar Harakia Mazirim, Et Nishmat, David Ben Nachum Shmuel, Shalacha L'Olamo, Begat Eden Tehem Menuchato, Ana Bal Harachamim, Hasterecha Resete Kinafecha L'Olamim, Utzur bitzur, hahayim et nishmato, arnaihu nachalato, v'yanuach b'shalom, al mishkovo, v'nomar, amen. El Malei Rachamim, exalted, compassionate God, grant infinite rest in your sheltering presence among the holy and pure to the soul of David ben Nachum Shmuel, who has gone to his eternal home. Merciful, we ask that our loved one find perfect peace in your eternal embrace. May his soul be bound up in the bond of life, and may he rest in peace always. And let us say, Amen. V'yashov ha'afar ha'aretz k'shahaya v'aruach tashuv el ha'elohim asher netana. The dust returns to the earth as it was, but the spirit returns to God who gave it. Adonai, Adonai el rachum v'chanun. The Lord our God is a compassionate God. He understands our pain and he shares our anguish. The dust returns to the earth from which it came, but the spirit goes back to God who gave it. What we put away are only the earthly material remains of the one we loved and cherished. What has been most precious to us never dies, but continues to bless and inspire us along the paths of life we tread. Their good name is a crown that will never fade. Their good life is a priceless memory to all their dear ones and to all of us. Receive in mercy and loving kindness, O Lord, the soul of our dear departed. Grant him that everlasting peace and bliss which are our portion in the world to come. May we all be given the strength, the courage, and the faith to be worthy of life and of the memory of those we loved. We now remain standing for the words of the mourner's Kaddish. Yitzgadal v'yikadash shemei rabah. V'yama divrach yurte v'yamlich machute v'chayehon v'yomechon v'chayeh d'chol beit Yisrael v'agala v'zman kari v'yemru Amen Yehe shmei rabba mevorach le'olam omei amaya Yitbarach v'yishtabach v'yitbar v'yitroman v'yitnase v'yitadar v'yitaleh v'yitalal shmei d'kudusha b'richu le'ela minkol berkata v'shirata Tush bechata v'nechemata, damiram bi'ama v'yemru, Amen. Yehe shlama rabba min shemaya, v'chayim aleinu v'yakol Yisrael v'yemru, Amen. Ose Shalom Bimromav, Hu Yaase Shalom, Aleinu V'Yakol Yisrael V'Imru, Amen. Everyone is invited to Amy and Stephen's home at 3019 Greenwood Glen Drive, and that is in Kingwood, immediately following our service. And your company will be greatly appreciated by the family. That's 3019 Greenwood Glen Drive in Kingwood. In just a moment, we'll have an opportunity to participate in the burial. I'll have the family go first and put some dirt in here, right on top of the coffin. And after all the family goes, then we'll close it, and then we'll have an opportunity for everyone, including family, to participate in the burial. It's a great mitzvah. It's considered a mitzvah chesed shel emet, a mitzvah we give back to David for all that he gave to us in his life. Hamakom yerechem etchem. May God offer comfort to all those who mourn for Zion and Jerusalem and for this family this morning and for the days, weeks to come. Let us now begin the burial. Good morning. We have come together today to share our sorrow and to bid farewell to David Blum. We recall today the blessing of his life, and we thank God for all that was good and true in his life, and for the precious memories that shall always endure. Eternal God, Creator and merciful Father of all, your children bowed in grief seek light to dispel the dark gloom. Be gracious to those who mourn, for they are in distress. Bless them with your compassion, O God. Ease their burden of sorrow. Send them light and peace. In this time, we now listen to the voice of our sacred scriptures that brings us the ever-new message of God's nearness. It tells us of our kinship with our Creator, and light is in darkness, and joy is in sorrow, and life is in death. Psalm 23. Mizmor le David, Adonai roi lo echsar, v'nodesha yirbatzeni, almei menuchot yinchaleni, nafshi yeshovev, v'nchene me'aglei tzedek leman shemo, lo ira ra ki ata imadi, shivtecha u'mishantecha hema, Yinachumuni, Torach lefanai shochan neged sorarai, Dishanta vashemen roshi kosi renaya, Ach tov vechesed yirafuni koyime hayai, Vashati bebeit adonai, Leorech yamim. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not fear. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in straight paths for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You have anointed my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Once, the poet Ralph Waldo Emerson wrote the following definition of success. It is the best one I have found, and I think truly defines our loved one David. Quote, he who has achieved success, who has lived well, laughed often, and loved much, who has enjoyed the trust of a pure woman, the respect of intelligent men, and the love of little children, who has filled his niche and accomplished his task, who has left the world better than he found it, who has never lacked appreciation of the earth's beauty or failed to express it, whose life was an inspiration, whose memory was a benediction. And this fits right in with the Jewish tradition's definition of success. As King David taught us in the book of Psalms, that the measure of success is one's ability to do the right thing day by day, every day. In this spirit, when we look back over the life of David Blum, we see a life of goodness, hard work, a devotion to family, and an undying love for his soulmate, Dolores. David was born on August 19, 1935, in the Hyde Park neighborhood of Chicago, Illinois, the eldest son of Alex and Martha Blum. He was blessed with two brothers, Jerry and Lenny. He graduated Hyde Park High School, where he played guard and linebacker for his high school football team. He went off to the University of Illinois, where he majored in accounting, and was a member of the Tau Epsilon Pi fraternity. Years later, David first met the love of his life at a Thanksgiving dinner, where David's cousin Margie invited her good friend, Dolores Fishman. Several years later, after seeing Dolores at the beach, David was smitten and mustered the courage to finally ask her out. Dolores said yes, but after a few dates, the yeses turned into noes. However, David did not despair. And after repeated requests, Dolores finally agreed to a date at a bowling banquet. According to him, his first and biggest sales job ever. This would be the turning point in their relationship, as his charm bowled her over, and they were married not long after at the Blackstone Hotel in Chicago. Soon after the marriage, they took an apartment on the south side of Chicago, where they began expanding their family. They were blessed with 5 children: Stephen, Kenny, Jeffrey, Diane, and Lisa. And after the birth of 3 boys, they soon moved into a home in Glencoe, Illinois. And desiring a girl, they were eventually blessed with twins. David always made activities fun for his family. He had a charisma and a beautiful smile that allowed him to often enjoy life, especially with those he loved. He was there as a father, and despite a difficult work and travel schedule, he would do the best he could to be there for his 5 children. David enjoyed spending time with his children and participated often in Cub Scouts and Indian Princesses. He had very high expectations of those he loved. He had a very competitive spirit, and he wanted everyone around him to be the best they could. He often pushed others to do more, whether they liked it or not. There was an expectation that, like him, you too would always do the right thing, would always be kind, and would always work hard. If you were going to do anything, you were going to do with all the passion you had, or you weren't going to do it at all. That is how David lived his life. For 55 years, he was blessed to be married to Dolores. He never said no to her. He adored her more than anyone. They spent most of their free time together. They loved each other's company and had a great respect for each other. She valued the fact that he worked hard and took care of her and the family. Yes, David was a physically big and very strong man, and at times he could get angry, but he would always come back and apologize and attempt to make it right. His expectations were always tempered by his kind and gentle neshama, his kind and gentle soul. Everyone respected him for it. He was a large, but yet a very gentle giant. And David adored Dolores, and despite both being very friendly people, they spent most of their free time in just enjoying each other's company, dining out, and traveling. Over the years, he and Dolores took the family on many trips to London, Paris, Israel, Disney World, Aruba, Italy, and the Ozarks. He especially enjoyed the many Memorial Day weekend fishing trips to Eagle River, Wisconsin, where despite a real lack of angler talent, he holds the family record for the biggest fish, a 30-inch, 7-pound walleye, proof of which is still hanging in a grandson's room. And most irksome, I've been told to his children, is that it was the first and only fish he ever caught. He was always up, nothing could hurt his morale. He was a real optimist with a special zest for life. He loved eating and trying everything. Eating out with him was extra special. If he couldn't decide what he wanted, he always ordered both sides, both dishes, one for the middle of the table for everyone to try. And not only could he appreciate fine dining, but he got more pleasure from eating at a Greasy Spoon or stopping at a local taqueria. A lifelong ambition for him was running a marathon, and in his mid-50s, he achieved his goal by completing the New York Marathon. In addition to his wife and his children and grandchildren, hard work would be the focus of his life. Initially, David supported the family by selling insurance, which he really didn't like, and filled the day mostly with going to the movies. However, as luck would have it, his father-in-law had just invented a new kind of tire and needed someone to drive sales. Bearcat Tire Company was born, and David leveraged his charisma and passion to excel, soon helping to build Bearcat into a leader in the industrial tire industry. Later, he would leave Bearcat to start his own industrial tire companies, Tire Town and Chicago Industrial Tire, selling and servicing customers around the world. In 1993, after a fire had forced the sale of Tire Town, David and Dolores moved here to Houston and started a new life in Kingwood. And David soon got busy building another business, and Phoenix Industrial Tire emerged from the embers of Tire Town. David would lead and grow this business up until his final 6 months of life. He'll be fondly remembered for his favorite slogan, "I don't care what you need to do, just get it done," as well as the words, "Caring is everything," emblazoned on the side of his truck. More importantly, he will be remembered for the countless employees he inspired to build their own businesses and be better people. David Bloom was a good man and a caring husband, father, brother, friend, grandfather, and mentor. He never said anything negative or unkind about anyone, even when deserved. First and foremost, David was a mensch. He survived by his wife of 55 years, Dolores, and 5 children, Lisa, Diane, Jeffrey, Stephen, and Kenneth. 3 daughter-in-laws, Mona, Amy, and Amy. He's also survived by 10 grandchildren. He was a wonderful Zadie to Sydney, Matthew, Evan, Samuel, Jared, Brandon, Benjamin, Jonathan, Maxwell, and Michael. David's influence will continue to be with so many of us for many years to come. His memory will remain as a valued example for future generations. How fortunate are all those who've been blessed by David Bloom. Today, David, we say farewell with pride that we knew you, with admiration for your strength and spirit and courage, with gratitude for all that you did give us. We say farewell with the prayer that God will grant you everlasting peace and that reward which the good and the loving receive in God's presence. Zikorno Livracha. May the good life of David Bloom be for a blessing to us always, and may his soul be bound up in the bond of eternal life, together with the souls of all the righteous that are in God's keeping. And to this let us say, Amen. It's my pleasure to have a few of his family members say some loving words about their father. First, his son, Stephen.
Good morning. Thank you for coming here to honor the memory of my father. When I was 16 or 17, my father invited me to join him on a business trip through the South Central USA. The plan was to visit Chattanooga, Tennessee, Tulsa, Oklahoma, and lastly, Houston, Texas. It would require that I miss about 3 or 4 days of school. I had not yet worked for my father and seen him in action, in his element, nor did I understand how this trip would impact my view of David Bloom as a father and a human being. I was glad just to miss school and spend a few days with him. I'm not sure which was more important at the time. I was soon to discover, however, that Dad was not just a good salesman. He was a different person than the man I knew at home. Before departing for the airport, we made a side trip to Fannie Mae Candies to get some gift boxes for the customers that we would be visiting. We pulled up to the strip mall, Dad entered the store, and strode to the counter. "I'd like a 10-pound box of candy," he called to the salesperson behind the counter. "Would 10 1-pound boxes be okay?" she replied. "They're over there at the display," pointing to the back of the store. "No, I'd like 1 10-pound box of candy," he answered with simple certainty. "I'm sorry, sir. I don't have any 10-pound boxes at the counter. I have to get them out of the back." "That's okay. We'll wait." I turned to Dad. "Dad, what's so important about a 10-pound box of candy? They have boxes over there, and we have a flight to catch." "Stephen," he said with a big smile on his face, "if I show up with a 1-pound box of candy, it's just like everybody else. If I show up with a 10-pound box, it's a conversation piece." Resuming our journey, we headed to the airport, 10-pound boxes of candy in tow. Our first stop was Chattanooga, Tennessee. I can't recall much about the actual business meetings that day or who we met, but remember vividly our lunch at the Chattanooga Choo Choo. We were joined by one other customer, making us a party of 3. It was still early, and the restaurant was only half full. Seating us immediately, the hostess distributed menus and took our beverage order. A quick glance at the menu informed the diner that the menu was limited and that there were only 4 entrees, instantly creating and resolving a dilemma for Dad. I had dined with him before, but our customer had not. He, our customer, ordered the ham. I ordered something long forgotten, and Dad ordered the remaining two entrees. While I was not surprised, and those of you who have dined with Dad are probably not either, our customer looked at Dad with a peculiar expression on his face. "I didn't know you were that hungry." "I'm not," said Dad, "but I always order something for Elijah so we can try it." The next morning, we boarded a plane for Tulsa. Exiting the plane, the tarmac greeted us with swirling gusts of red rose dust. With the support of Hearst's, we were soon dashing to our next customer, one of Tulsa's premier forklift dealers. Dad announced us to the receptionist, where the sales manager enthusiastically welcomed and escorted us into their conference room. After five or six quick introductions of Dad to various members of the dealership staff, we took our seats and the performance began. Dad was dazzling. And a ham. I had seen him make presentations at school and lead Cub Scout pack meetings, but I had never seen him perform in front of an audience. "My name is Dave Bloom," he started, looking at the others with eyes bright and voice animated. "I got into this business by marrying the boss's daughter of Bearcat Tire Company." Amid chuckles, my focus faded as I watched the transformation of Dad from my father to professional. He commanded the attention of every person in the room, fielding questions and explaining sales strategies, showcasing the facet of him I had never seen before, and providing a glimpse into what I have come to understand was the real source of his strength, the confidence and passion of a salesman who truly believes in the value of what he is selling. My respect and admiration for his capabilities grew. I had heard his introduction often. Marrying Dolores Fishman was his greatest achievement, second only to the pride he took in his sons and daughters. Dad wrapped up the meeting, obtaining order commitments for his new line of imported European tires, but declined lunch. Houston was our final destination, and our schedule was tight. With minutes to spare, we were soon relaxing on our next flight. We arrived in Houston on a cloudless but humid night in late spring. I was tired and a bit bored from the endless jetting, but looking forward to my last evening with Dad. In the morning, he had scheduled an appointment at Gulf Co., a foundry located in Beaumont, and the last scene of our trip together. Dressed in business suits and Oxfords, the dawn found us driving on I-10 amidst darkened skies, dodging occasional downpours. Reaching our destination, we were soon seated in the cramped office of the general manager, where Dad began explaining the features of his new tires and the benefits they would bring to Gulf Co. The plant manager wouldn't hear it. "We have a very demanding environment here at Gulf Co., and standard tires won't hold up. We only use laminated tires, custom made for our application." I expected Dad to give up, as the manager was clearly uninterested. Instead, he tacked. "Can we have a plant tour?" he requested. "Sure, come on," the manager replied, jumping from his seat. The skies had cleared, but still carried an ominous potential. Black thunderheads loomed in the distance, threatening to release their angry torrent. Following the manager, Dad and I toured the presses, forges, furnaces, and yard. To my untrained eye, the place was a dump, literally. Among puddles and patches of grass and gravel, the yard was strewn with old tires, rusting machinery, and irregular forgings. Some of the junk heaps were 5 to 6 feet high. Dad wandered off, leaving me to chat with the plant manager. Dressed in his suit and shoes, he began hopping and climbing over all the old tires, examining them with the eye of a forensic scientist looking for a cause of failure. The image was comical. He looked like a 6-foot, spindly-legged, barrel-chested sprite flitting from one tire to the next. An elven Humpty Dumpty. Upon completing his examination, he shouted to the plant manager, "Would you please come over here and take a look at this?" Without going into technical detail, Dad took the next 30 minutes to patiently explain and show to the plant manager that the laminated tires he had so proudly exclaimed had solved one problem and created another, more costly problem. Walking back to the office, the humbled plant manager thanked Dad for such a refreshing and eye-opening experience and promised to get back with him. He never did. As we drove back to the airport for a return to Chicago, we discussed this last appointment and what had happened. Steven, he said, I told you, the best salesmen aren't problem solvers, they're problem creators. It's almost 40 years since we spent those days together as father and son. Days that are just as clear to me today as they were that spring. I've lost a good friend, father, and teacher. I will miss his smile, but take comfort knowing that I will always carry a piece of him with me inside.
Hello, thank you for coming. For those that don't know me, I'm Jeff Bloom. I'm the third son. I wanted to say a few words. I didn't prepare as much as Stephen did. And Rabbi, thank you for those words. You stole a lot of my material while I'm up here. But I guess first, just a little humor. When we were all planning where the funeral would be, we talked about whether we should do it in Houston or in Chicago. And obviously we're here in Houston. And as my cousin Ross pointed out to me yesterday, he said the heat index is going to be 108. I checked this morning on the way while I was actually preparing what I was going to talk about. I think the heat index was 76, low humidity, much more comfortable. So David apologizes. We all apologize for the heat. What I'm here to talk about really is a son's love for his father. I didn't prepare a lot. It's a kind of a collection of random thoughts. I loved my father very, very much, and I think all of us here did as well. He was a special man who had a big impact on many of us. I kind of broke this into, David as the teacher, to me personally, David as a role model, and then David as kind of just being playful. As a teacher, I think the theme of get it done, Jeffrey, was something that I heard constantly. In fact, when I went to visit him, 3 weeks ago, and he was on his deathbed, literally. Here I am trying to do a special project for myself. It's not yet done. I have a difficult client. And in his kind of very shallow voice, he said those words to me, Jeffrey, just get it done. And it was. And now that we're talking about it here, it's very special. And it's something that I will carry with me for a long, long time. Finishing. Some of you may not know the story of my personal story about my boat. I was not allowed to go to college. In fact, I probably still have to give back my degree because I wasn't supposed to go to college.
It's still unfinished.
And it's still unfinished. And I'll admit that today, it is still unfinished. But I was not supposed to go to college until my boat was finished. And I will tell you, my poor wife, my sons are tortured by that recurring, just finish it. All of my wife's projects, they're not finished. I always say, we finish them. So thank you. Thank you, David. What else? A couple of things. I was talking to Benny about what Zadie has taught him. And on a light-sided note, he mentioned the cardboard keyboard. He always talked about the expertise he had being able to play the cardboard keyboard. And then the last one, I guess, is about eating. His zest for enjoying food, always ordering two of everything. It was wonderful. We loved and enjoyed all that time with him. So moving on to a role model, hard work. I think it instilled upon many of us his ability to work very, very hard. Even when he had colon cancer back in 8 years ago or 7 years ago, whatever it was, he still was getting into that truck. And he'd go and get his chemo, he'd get back in that truck, and he would go drive, do some calls, help, in the back. It was incredible. I personally, I don't think I could ever go through that type of suffering in terms of recovering and still be able to work. An inspiration to all of us. Perseverance, strength, grit, all similar to the same thing. Much of the things that he shared with me. But on a gentler note, his kindness. David was a very kind and very loving father, man, friend to me and to many of us. And I think that that is as a role model to me personally, something that's very, very special. Last piece is around playfulness. I was, and I still am, a little competitive with my brothers and my family and my father. Many of you don't know, I competed against my father in throwing a football regularly. And up until he was, I was going to bring a football just 3 weeks ago to challenge him to a thing. He had his hip replaced, and I was still competing against him to see who could throw the ball further. At that time, I was throwing it further than him, but it took until the hip replacement to ultimately be the one to do it. I'm gonna end there. I guess there are some things about my legendary fights with him as a son. They were never ending, and I will forever miss them. They were beautiful moments. That's the spoons. That's what I was talking about. Yes, it was beautiful. But I'm just gonna end on this. And I think that this fits into the role model for all of us. We were all in Kemahatchee. I think most of us were there in Northbrook, Illinois. I don't think, Steve, if you were there at the time. And there were sitting there was four or five or six or eight or whatever the number of children and his son-in-laws and daughter-in-laws, and 8, 9, 10, there may have been some friends that were thrown in there of his grandkids thrown in there. So in front of him, he was sitting there, and there were 18 children and children of his that he has had a life with, and he has had such an influence with. And I was just talking to him, and we all knew his health was failing. And I just asked him, I said, how does this, behold, all of this is before you. How do you feel about this? And the peace that he had when he said, nothing makes me happier, is something that we all should cherish, and we should all hope for ourselves that we could have. So, thank you.
Thank you, Stephen, and thank you, Jeffrey. And may you continue to share those positive memories, those blessings, that precious legacy with the grandchildren and one day the great-grandchildren. So the Zikrono Livracha, so his memory is always a blessing, and that he always continues to rest in peace. You have a lot to be proud about, and may continue to share those proud memories for many, many years to come. Now I ask you to please rise for the El Malei Rachamim. El Malei Rachamim, Shokein Bam Romim, Hameneitza Menucha Nechona Tachat Kanvei Hashkina, Bema'alot Kiddushim Utoharim, Kizohar Harakia Mazirim, Et Nishmat David Ben Nachum Shmuel, Shalacha Leolamo, Begad Eden Tehem Menuchato, Ana Bal Harachamim, Hasterecha Reseter Kenafecha Leolamim, Utzor bitzor, hahayim et nishmato, arnaihu nachalato, v'anuach b'shalom, al mishkovo, v'nomar, amen. El Malei Rachamim, exalted, compassionate God, grant infinite rest in your sheltering presence among the holy and pure to the soul of David ben Nachum Shmuel, who has gone to his eternal home. Merciful, we ask that our loved one find perfect peace in your eternal embrace. May his soul be bound up in the bond of life, and may he rest in peace always. And let us say, Amen. V'yashov ha'afar ha'aretz k'shahaya v'aruach tashuv el ha'elohim asher netana. The dust returns to the earth as it was, but the spirit returns to God who gave it. Adonai, Adonai el rachum v'chanun. The Lord our God is a compassionate God. He understands our pain and he shares our anguish. The dust returns to the earth from which it came, but the spirit goes back to God who gave it. What we put away are only the earthly material remains of the one we loved and cherished. What has been most precious to us never dies, but continues to bless and inspire us on the paths of life we tread. Their good name is a crown that will never fade. their good life is a priceless memory to all their dear ones and to all of us. Receive in mercy and loving kindness, O Lord, the soul of our dear departed. Grant him that everlasting peace and bliss which are our portion in the world to come. May we all be given the strength, the courage, and the faith to be worthy of life and of the memory of those we loved. We now remain standing for the words of the mourner's Kaddish. Yitzgadal v'yikadash shemei rabah v'yamah divrach yirutei v'yamlich machutei v'chayichon v'yomeichon v'chayei d'chol beit Yisrael v'agala v'zman kari v'yimru amen yehe shemei rabah mevorach le'olam ome amaya yitbarach v'yishtabach v'yitbar v'yitroman v'yitnase v'yitadar v'yitale v'yitalal shemei d'kudusha b'richu Le'ela minkol berkata v'shirata, tush bechata v'nechemata, damiram b'yama v'yemru amen. Yehe shlama rabba min shemaya, v'chayim aleinu v'yakol Yisrael v'yemru amen. Ose shalom bimromav, hu ya'ase shalom, aleinu v'yakol Yisrael v'yemru amen. Everyone is invited to Amy and Stephen's home at 3019 Greenwood Glen Drive, and that is in Kingwood, immediately following our service. And your company will be greatly appreciated by the family. That's 3019 Greenwood Glen Drive in Kingwood. In just a moment, we'll have an opportunity to participate in the burial. I'll have the family go first and put some dirt in here, right on top of the coffin. And after all the family goes, then we'll close it. And then we'll have an opportunity for everyone, including family, to participate in the burial. It's a great mitzvah. It's considered a mitzvah chesed shel emet, a mitzvah we give back to David for all that he gave to us in his life. Hamakom yerechem etchem. May God offer comfort to all those who mourn for Zion and Jerusalem and for this family this morning and for the days, weeks to come. And let us now begin the burial.